Good evening, y'all, and welcome to this edition of History in Highballs. We're so glad that you're joining us for this evening's program, History in Highballs, Theodosia Burr, and the Nags Head Portrait. My name is Stacy, and I handle adult education here at the museum. So whenever you join us for one of these History in Highballs programs, you and I get to virtually spend the evening together listening to some incredible stories about North Carolina places and people and what makes our state so special. If you enjoyed tonight's program, we invite you to head over to the museum's website at www.ncmuseumofhistory.org, where you can learn more about upcoming programs, exhibits, and digital resources. This is also where you can find out more information about shopping at our wonderful museum shop and joining the North Carolina Museum of History Associates. Our associates and foundation provide crucial funding and support to the museum, in addition to many other things, helps make programming like this evening's event possible. We would like to also thank all of those of you who donated funds towards this evening's program. We do our best to keep our programs free to attend, but there are costs associated with keeping our series going. And we just continue to be so appreciative of your generous support of the museum and its programming, especially over the last year and a half. A few housekeeping items for this evening. We ask that you please keep your mics muted throughout the entirety of the program and to please type any questions that you have for our guest speakers into the chat function located at the bottom center of your screen. At the end of our program, I will ask our speakers as many of your questions as time allows. So it's my honor to introduce this evening's speakers, Marjorie Berry, historian for Pasquotank County, and Robin Salmon, VP of Art and Historical Collections and Curator of Sculpture at Brookgreen Gardens. A native of Elizabeth City, North Carolina, Berry is a graduate of St. Mary's College and the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. She worked at the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History from 1984 to 1993, and is the author of Legendary Locals of Elizabeth City. Berry is the historian for Pasquotank County, and since 2003 has been the researcher and scriptwriter for the historic Elizabeth City Ghost Walk, a living history event held every October. A native of Columbia, South Carolina, Salmon has been on the staff of Brookgreen Gardens since 1975. She oversees the acquisition, exhibition, and conservation of Brookgreen's art, history, library, and archives collection. She is a graduate of the University of South Carolina and the Museum Management Institute. She is an allied professional member of the National Sculpture Society, serves on its board of directors, and is co-editor of its publication, Sculpture Review. She also serves on the Citizens Coinage Advisory Committee of the United States Mint, selecting designs for the nation's circulating and commemorative coins and medals. She's written 5 books on Brookgreen Gardens, co-authored 8 books on other art and history subjects, and provided numerous essays and articles for exhibit catalogs, magazines, and other publications. Welcome to both of you. Thanks so much for being with us. Robin, I believe you're gonna lead us off for this evening, so the floor is officially yours.
Oh, thank you, Stacy. Can everyone hear me? I hope.
Yes.
Okay. The PowerPoint is illustrated with various portraits of Aaron Burr, Theodosia Burr, and Joseph Alston, along with some other images. So if you see different images of the same person, don't be surprised. Oh my. Okay, this is not moving forward.
There you go.
Colonel William Alston of South Carolina was a member of Francis Marion's brigade during the American Revolution and participated in the defense of Georgetown. Known as King Billy, he dropped the second L from his last name to distinguish his family from that of his cousin, William Alston of Brookgreen. His father, Joseph Alston, known as Joseph of the Oaks, left him Clifton Plantation on the Waccamaw Neck. William Alston was a respected breeder of horses and a rice planter in the Georgetown region. And when George Washington came to South Carolina in 1791, after spending the night at Brookgreen with Henry and Rachel Flagg, Washington had breakfast at William Alston's Clifton. As a member of the South Carolina Senate, Alston supported Thomas Jefferson's programs. And it's important to know that piece of information. William Alston was married twice. His first wife, Mary Ash, gave him 4 children, and the eldest was Joseph Alston, whom you see here. He attended what is now Princeton University and graduated college before he turned 17. He studied law in the offices of Edward Rutledge, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, and was admitted to the bar by 1799, although he never established his own law practice. Joseph was from a wealthy family and was wealthy in his own right from the inheritance of the Oaks, a prosperous rice plantation in Georgetown County, left to him by his paternal grandfather, for whom he was named. At the encouragement of his father, he made his appearances in northern social circles. In New York in the late 1790s, Joseph met his future wife, Theodosia Burr, daughter of Aaron Burr. And allow me to provide a sidebar on Aaron Burr. Powerful political rivals vilified Aaron Burr during his lifetime. And for the next 200 years, historians and novelists largely followed suit. The former senator from New York and U.S. vice president under Thomas Jefferson has been characterized as an ambitious opportunist who attempted to steal the 1800 election from Jefferson, a cold-blooded murderer who thought nothing of killing Alexander Hamilton in a duel, and a traitor who supposedly tried to annex Spanish territory in Louisiana, Mexico, and establish himself as the ruler of a new empire. But in recent years, a less dastardly Aaron Burr has come into focus. More democratic in his political philosophy than either Hamilton or Jefferson, Burr is now recognized as an early advocate of reforms aimed at making America a more egalitarian country. He proposed abolishing slavery in 1785, broke the Federalist New York banking monopoly in 1799, and eloquently defended the rights of naturalized immigrants in the same year. Above all else, it is Burr's enlightened advocacy of women's rights that has made him appear more heroic than villainous. Burr credited his wife, the former Theodosia Prevost, with opening his eyes to the intellectual capacities of women. But it was his daughter, Theodosia, who attuned him to the importance of gender-neutral education in developing a woman's full potential. Not long after Theodosia's birth in 1783, Burr became obsessed with providing her with every educational opportunity. By the age of 3, she had learned to read and write, studied Latin, Greek, and French, and by her 10th birthday, she had finished all 6 volumes of Edward Gibbon's The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. Theodosia's mother helped implement the educational curriculum, and when she died in 1794, Burr encouraged a French governess, Madame Sinnott, to establish a school at his New York townhouse for his daughter's benefit. He also invited the governess's aristocratic young charge, Natalie Delage, to live with Theodosia as her constant companion and model of European sophistication. Fortunately, Burr's idea proved successful, and the girls, just 8 months apart in age, became lifelong friends. And Natalie also married a South Carolinian, Thomas Sumter Jr., whose father distinguished himself in the American Revolution, earning the nickname the Gamecock. Theodosia's and Natalie's appearances at age 13 were captured in 1796 by a pair of engraved profile portraits by St. Memmon, which you see on the screen, that are now part of the National Portrait Gallery collection. Also in 1796, Theodosia's tutor, Michel Martin, dedicated his new textbook to her, citing her father's belief, quote, that women, whatever may be said, are capable of the same kind of genius as men, and his hope that by developing within you the distinctive qualities of a man, Theodosia might avenge your sex of the conceit, as well as the tyranny of laws and conventions that enchain women within a bastion of ignorance. Now, back to the story of Theodosia and Joseph. Aaron Burr recognized the political promise in Joseph Alston, as well as entertained the possibility of how Alston's wealth and influence could help him in his quest for the presidency. Joseph was interested in a career in politics and the political influence of Aaron Burr. Theodosia apparently saw the profits of social, political, and economic status that the marriage could bring, although she wasn't easily persuaded. At the age of 17, she was one of the most talented and sought-after women in New York society, even attracting the attentions of the painter John Vanderlyn, shown here, and the writer Washington Irving. Supposedly, the eye of Theodosia, that you see on the right, was painted by Vanderlyn as a memento of his love, and he wore it on his lapel for the rest of his life. Considering the competition and realizing that she was not inclined to life in Southern society, Joseph wrote an elegant letter romanticizing the issue of slavery, class structure, horse racing, and hunting, and stated that morality, honesty, and virtue so commonly permeated society that it was seldom acknowledged. Still reluctant to make a commitment, Theodosia responded saying that Aristotle advised no man should marry before reaching 30. Joseph replied, "Suppose, merely for instance, a young man nearly 22, already of the greatest discretion, with an ample fortune, were to be passionately in love with a young lady about 18, equally discreet with himself, and who had a sincere friendship for him. Do you think it would be necessary to make him wait till 30? Particularly where friends on both sides were pleased with the match?" They were married on February 2, 1801, in Albany, New York, and they became the first celebrity couple to honeymoon at Niagara Falls. Only 4 days after the marriage, gossip was making its rounds, and it was biased against Joseph. Maria Nicholson wrote to her sister, Mrs. Albert Gallatin, wife of Burr's close political friend, complaining, "Report does not speak well of him. It says that he is rich, but he is a great dasher, dissipated, ill-tempered, vain, and silly. I know that he is ugly and of unprepossessing manners. Can it be that the father has sacrificed a daughter to affluence and influential connections?" They say that it was Mr. A. who gained the 8 votes in Carolina at the present election, and that he is not yet relieved from pecuniary embarrassments. After a brief stay at Richmond Hill, Aaron Burr's home on the Hudson River, Joseph and Theodosia traveled to Baltimore, met with her father on March the 4th, and rode with him to the Capitol in Washington. There they watched John Marshall administer the oath to Aaron Burr as he was inaugurated Vice President of the United States. They returned to the Waccamaw Neck and stayed with Joseph's brother, John Ash Alston, you see there, at his Hagley plantation, while the house built by Joseph's grandfather at the Oaks was remodeled, although they couldn't move in until Joseph turned 24 and was legally able to acquire his inheritance. Joseph entered politics in South Carolina in 1802 when he was elected to the legislature and served there until December 10, 1812, when he was elected governor. By 1810, the census recorded the presence of 225 enslaved Africans at the Oaks. The house at the Oaks wasn't as grand compared to others in the community, although the interior had been plastered and other improvements made, but it had not been enlarged significantly. Archaeological investigations suggest that the overall size of the first floor was 32.5 feet by 42 feet, or 1,365 square feet, and it was raised on piers 4 to 6 feet high. It's presumed that it was two-story with an unfinished attic, as were other houses in the area. Aaron Burr wrote consolingly to Theodosia, "I am gratified that you do not start with splendor." Theodosia preferred to spend time at their home in Charleston and went there as often as she could, desiring the social and cultural opportunities of the city. The story of Joseph and Theodosia Alston is one of love and tragedy. The young couple began happy and prosperous. Joseph's political star was on the rise, pushed by his father and father-in-law. Theodosia was trying to adjust to South Carolina, although it was quite a change from her native New York. But things turned sour. As she was a highly educated and accomplished woman in a time when most women, even the daughters of well-to-do rice planters, did not have those opportunities, she never fit in. Many in the rice planter circles did not accept her and thought her to be haughty and her mannerisms to be inappropriate in comparison to those of other women. In 1802, Theodosia had given birth to a son, Aaron Burr Alston, giving new hope to the Alston family. Unfortunately, the birth resulted in years of trauma and sickness from which Theodosia never fully recovered. Not only did this create bodily disorders, resulting infections and other afflictions, but she later injured her spine during a severe fall and was bedridden for several months. She spent considerable time away from home, visiting physicians and mineral springs, and often sought the company of her father. By this time, Aaron Burr began to sell off parts of his property at Richmond Hill in New York in order to satisfy debts, and the house went in 1804. The place that Theodosia knew and loved, the source of happy childhood memories, and a retreat from plantation life was no longer available to her. Then Aaron Burr was charged with murder after Alexander Hamilton died in a duel in 1804. In a letter sent to Joseph Alston the night before his duel with Hamilton, Burr worried over Theodosia's fate should he die. "Let me entreat you to stimulate and aid Theodosia in the cultivation of her mind," he begged Alston. "It is indispensable for her happiness and essential to yours." Knowing that his egalitarian views were not shared by most men, perhaps not even by his daughter's husband, Burr added, "If you should differ with me as to the importance of this measure, suffer me to ask it of you as a last favor." Although Hamilton died, Burr eventually was vindicated, but the damage was done to his public image. In 1805, while obviously depressed over this and her physical condition, which seemed untreatable, Theodosia had written a letter to her father, which she never mailed, saying, "Something whispers to me that my end approaches. I am now standing on the brink of eternity." Then in 1807, Aaron Burr was arrested for treason in a plan to colonize the lands west of the Mississippi River and create a new country. During the trial held in Richmond, Virginia, with Chief Justice John Marshall presiding, there were questions as to whether Joseph and Theodosia were involved in the plan, but they were never charged. Burr's guilt could not be proven as there were too many versions of the alleged treasonous plan. Witnesses, both for the defense and the accusers, could not agree on what really had happened, and Aaron Burr was acquitted. Even so, the Alstons felt embarrassment by virtue of association, and in 1808, Burr decided the best alternative was to leave the country, and he sailed for France. Theodosia suffered in his absence. Meanwhile, as South Carolina's Speaker of the House, Joseph Alston was an effective orator and strongly supported equality between the upper and lower parts of the state, and was the primary supporter of the Constitutional Amendment of 1808, providing equal representation between the farmers of the upcountry and the rice planters of the lowcountry. He also strongly opposed the reopening of the slave trade in 1808. Her child was the light of her life, especially with her father away, and Joseph often traveling on business related to government or the plantation. In 1808, she was encouraged after seeing Dr. William Eustace, a friend and physician of her father in New York, who gave her medicine that seemed to help her affliction. She wrote, "You'll restore me to health, to enjoyment, to all the pleasing duties of domestic life. This deadened heart will once more beat with rapture when my boy returns to my arms. I shall again dwell with delight on the beauties of nature and enter with zeal into all my former interesting occupations." To escape the summer months on the rice plantation and the fever that was not yet known as malaria, many plantation owners went to their summer homes on the beaches or in the mountains. William Alston, Joseph's father, had a place at Debedieu Island on the southern end of the Waccamaw Neck, where Joseph and Theodosia sometimes stayed. Also, Joseph purchased 205 acres on the Reedy River near the settlement of Pleasantburg, now known as Greenville, South Carolina. The Alstons spent the summers of 1810, 1811, and part of 1812 there. Joseph left early to campaign for the forthcoming election, taking Theodosia and their son. They returned to the retreat on Debedieu Island in June 1812, but Aaron Burr Alston died of malaria there at the age of 10. Theodosia weakened further and suffered from severe depression. She wrote to her father, "There is no more joy for me. The world is blank. I have lost my boy. My child is gone forever. My head is not now sufficiently collected to say anything further." When her father returned to New York, Theodosia begged to be able to visit him and wanted Joseph to go with her, but he was governor of South Carolina and the nation was at war with England. A trip overland was out of the question due to her fragile physical condition, so it was decided that she would go by ship, although Joseph had reservations about that because of the war. Nearly all the usual sailing vessels on which she might have traveled had been seized by the Navy. However, Joseph eventually found the Patriot, a small schooner that wasn't much larger than a present-day pilot boat. Joseph traveled with Theodosia from the Oaks down the Waccamaw River to Georgetown, South Carolina, where she spent the night in the Merry Man House on Bay Street near the harbor. The Patriot left Georgetown Harbor on the morning of December 30, 1812, and was never seen again. Joseph Alston wrote to Aaron Burr in February of 1813, "This then is the end of all the hopes we had formed. Oh, my friend, if there be such a thing as this sublime of misery, it is for us that it has been reserved." Joseph died 3 years later in 1816 at the age of 37 and was buried at the Oaks in the Alston Family Cemetery, where other members of his family, including his son, were laid to rest. His epitaph reads, "Sacred to the memory of Joseph and Theodosia Burr Alston and their son, Aaron Burr Alston. The last died in June 1812 at the age of 10 years, and his remains are interred here. The disconsolate mother perished a few months after at sea, and on the 10th September 1816 died the father, when but little over 37 years of age, whose remains rest here with the sons. The life of this citizen was no common one to the state. To its service he devoted himself from his early years. On the floors of its legislature, he was distinguished for his extensive information and his transcendent eloquence in the chair of the House of Representatives, for his impartial, correct decisions, and everywhere he was distinguished for his zealous attachments to his Republican principles. In the capacity of chief magistrate of the state, when both the honor and the responsibility of the office were heightened by the difficulties and dangers of the War of 1812, he, by his indomitable activity and his salutary measures, earned new titles to the respect and gratitude of his fellow citizens. This great man was also a good one. He met death with that fortitude with which his ancestor did, from whom he received his name and this estate, and which is to be found only in the good hoping to rejoin those whose loss had left in his heart an aching void that nothing on earth could fill." Thank you.
Thank you so much, Robin, for that incredible history of both the Burrs and the Alstons. Marjorie, I believe that you are going to share with us now about the Nags Head portrait. Okay. There you are.
Okay, I'm having some connectivity problems, but I'm hoping it's straight now.
Okay.
Share screen. Is that right?
Here is your PowerPoint. Close that up.
Maybe it's already on. Okay.
Here's your PowerPoint.
I don't see it.
It's your screen.
Okay.
Here's your PowerPoint.
I don't know. Do I hit this?
Did you pull your power? Hit mute for just a second.
Okay. Hold on. Just give me just a
Of course.
you should be good to go.
Okay. All right, y'all. I think we're straight.
Yeah, that was perfect. Okay, the floor is yours, Marjorie.
All right, thank you. The painting that you're looking at is known as the Nags Head Portrait. This 200-year-old painting is one of the most mysterious artifacts in American history. Its story is one of serendipitous discovery, a nefarious founding father, a devoted daughter, a shipwreck, pirates, and two centuries of conjecture. The painting came to light the summer of 1869. How do I go to the next one? Just like this. Wait a minute. It's not a good one. Of that, okay. The painting came to light the summer of 1869. Dr. William G. Poole of Elizabeth City is vacationing at his Nags Head cottage when he is called to the bedside of Mrs. Polly Mann, an elderly fisherman's widow living in Nags Head Woods. Entering her crude hovel, he is struck by an oil painting of an aristocratic young woman hanging on the walls of the shack. He inquired about the portrait, and Mrs. Mann told him this tale. When she was a young girl, when we were fighting the British, she said, a ship ran aground one winter day and was wrecked near Nags Head. The wreckers boarded the ship, finding no one aboard, and proceeded to loot the vessel. One of the wreckers was Joseph Tillett, Mrs. Mann's sweetheart at the time. His share of the loot included two black silk dresses and the portrait, all of which he gave to Mrs. Mann. Dr. Poole convinced Mrs. Mann to give him the portrait in exchange for his services, and he took it to his home on the Pasquotank River. Dr. Poole was a worldly, well-educated man, and the portrait intrigued him. He conducted extensive research, and before long, he concluded that what he had was a portrait of Aaron Burr's daughter, Theodosia, who was lost at sea in 1813. Now let's go back in time 56 years. It's December of 1812. Theodosia is the wife of Joseph Alston, a wealthy planter and the governor of South Carolina. The Alstons have recently lost their only child, Aaron Burr Alston, who died of a fever at age 12. Theodosia's father, Aaron Burr, has just returned to New York City from 4 years of self-imposed exile in Europe. Theodosia is sickly, low in spirits, and desperate to reunite with her father in New York. On December 30th, 1812, Theodosia boards the schooner Patriot en route to New York. At around noon that day, the Patriot leaves the harbor at Georgetown, South Carolina, and crosses the bar to the open sea. The boat, its passengers, and crew are never seen again. Days, then weeks go by, and Theodosia fails to arrive in New York. A frantic Aaron Burr sends inquiries up and down the East Coast as to the fate of the Patriot. The most workable clue comes from the admiral of the British fleet. Remember that the War of 1812 was raging at the time, and the British warships lay in wait off the North Carolina coast. The admiral reported that a savage storm hit off Cape Hatteras the afternoon of January 2nd and continued with near hurricane force winds most of the day. The Patriot would likely have been off the Outer Banks at this time. The British fleet was badly battered, and it was the opinion of the admiral that the Patriot could not have survived the storm. Over time, Aaron Burr came to accept that the Patriot went down in the gale and his daughter perished at sea. But wait, the scenario then became complicated by pirate confessions. Within 10 years of Theodosia's disappearance, deathbed confessions from former pirates began to surface, all proclaiming that they were part of pirate crews who captured the Patriot, forcing all aboard to walk the plank. At this point, inevitably, the old pirate telling the tale would start to cry, describing how beautiful Theodosia was as she stepped into the sea. Upon inspection, all of the pirate stories proved to be fatally flawed. The most credible one involved two pirates about to be executed in Mississippi. The two said that they were crew members on the Patriot who mutinied, imprisoned the passengers and crew below deck, and took off in a smaller boat with loot from the Patriot. But even that story held discrepancies and no mention of a violent storm. So was Theodosia Burr Austin drowned at sea in January 1813? Was she killed by pirates? Most importantly, how did a portrait, supposedly an image of her, appear at Nag's Head around the same time the Patriot disappeared? Let's revisit Mrs. Mann's story about how she got the portrait. The Outer Banks inhabitants of the early 19th century were a desperate, uncivilized people who made a living mainly from wrecking. If a ship ran aground on the dangerous shoals of the graveyard of the Atlantic, that was the wrecker's great good fortune, and they were not averse to killing those aboard the ship to get at their bounty. If Providence failed to provide them with a shipwreck, they made their own luck. This, of course, is the Nag's Head legend. Land pirates would need to lead a nag along the shore with a lantern tied around its neck. Ships at sea, seeing the bobbing light, would steer towards what they thought was a safe harbor, then crash onto the shoals to the glee of the wreckers. Mrs. Mann was not forthcoming with her tale of the ship and the portrait. Dr. Poole had to drag it out of her, and he always felt that there was something she was not telling. Was the ship really abandoned when it came ashore, or were the passengers and crew slaughtered by the wreckers? Anything's possible. Some historians have conjectured that Mrs. Mann was Theodosia herself, that she came ashore clutching the portrait and her life was spared by the wreckers because she'd taken leave of her senses. Again, anything is possible, but I think this unlikely. One scenario that would dovetail with Mrs. Mann's story with the pirate stories is the possibility that sea pirates raided the Patriot, killing all aboard, then were surprised by a warship or other official vessel and had to abort their evil mission. That way, the Patriot could have drifted ashore, abandoned and intact, as Mrs. Mann had reported. To play devil's advocate, maybe the painting is not a likeness of Theodosia at all, but I think this too is unlikely. Previous portraits show the same curly auburn hair, the same dark eyes and straight nose. And there is a rounded fullness to the jawline in all the portraits that is also apparent in the Nag's Head portrait. On the left is a watercolor of Theodosia painted at the time of her marriage in 1801. On the right is the Nag's Head portrait, probably painted sometime between 1810 and 1812. If you compare the features, the forehead and hairline are the same. And both images share the same dark eyes. The noses bear the same shape. Even the ears are remarkably similar. Both sets of lips share the same contours with a slight lifting at each corner. The image on the left shows a fresher, more attractive young woman, but we have to remember that Theodosia went through a lot of traumatic events in the 12 years following her marriage. During this period, her father, while serving as Vice President of the United States, killed Alexander Hamilton in a duel, an act that made him very unpopular. He followed this up by raising an army to take over the western part of the country and set himself up as emperor. This got him a protracted trial for treason, which took place in Richmond, Virginia. Theodosia was by his side with unconditional support every inch of the way. Theodosia herself had been in poor health since the birth of her son in 1802. She suffered a prolapsed uterus during the birth, for which there was no cure. As a result, she endured constant pain for the rest of her life. In 1808, Aaron Burr fled the country for Europe, dodging creditors and general ill will. The four-year separation was hard on both father and daughter. The crushing blow of Theodosia's life came in 1812, just before Burr's return to America, when her only child died suddenly of a fever. so it's not surprising that she would present an older, more worn visage in the later portrait. There is no record that Theodosia carried a portrait of herself on board the Patriot, but it would have been a logical gift for her father. And the time period of Mrs. Mann's story matches the time that Theodosia disappeared. The bankers knew the country was at war with the British because of the military flotsam that was washing ashore on the beaches. And there is no record of any other civilian vessel except the Patriot being lost in January of 1813. Most importantly, over the past 150 years, this portrait has been reproduced hundreds of times, appearing in publication after publication, and no one has ever come forward claiming it to be a portrait of someone else. The portrait is unsigned and undated. The frame bears a label stating that it was painted by John Vanderlyn, a noted portraitist of the day. It was the art historian John Stilwell who dubbed it the work of Vanderlyn, though research has shown that this is not likely. John Vanderlyn was living in Europe from 1803 to 1850 and was not known to have set foot on American soil during that time. It's more likely that it was a Charleston artist who executed the painting, or even an itinerant painter who visited Georgetown. Predictably, Theodosia's story has stirred the imagination of writers for 150 years. It's been fodder for magazines, plays, books, and poetry, including Robert Frost's poem, Kitty Hawk, and many highly romanticized historical novels. Ever a part of the changing popular culture, here's a pulp magazine cover from 1954 depicting Theodosia in Hollywood starlet mode. Even the Broadway musical Hamilton features a number called Dear Theodosia. Here I'd like to mention an interesting aside about Alexander Hamilton. As a young man, Hamilton almost perished in a storm off Cape Hatteras. He vowed that if he survived, he would lobby Congress for a lighthouse to warn mariners of that dangerous stretch of coastline. That's how the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse came to be. This is the lighthouse in its earliest incarnation, which looks nothing like it does today. The lighthouse became known locally as Mr. Hamilton's Light. Ironically, the last sight Theodosia may have seen before she died was the Cape Hatteras Lighthouse, the creation of her father's old nemesis. Dr. Poole, for his part, was convinced that the portrait was a likeness of Theodosia Burr Austin. For the rest of his life, he attempted to authenticate this. He queried many members of the Burr and Austin families, sending them copies of the portrait. The Burr descendants were also convinced that the portrait was of Theodosia, while the Austin family members were less enthusiastic. In 1878, Dr. Poole sent a photo of the portrait to Mary Austin Pringle, Joseph Austin's youngest sister, and the only surviving family member who had seen Theodosia in life. Mrs. Pringle was 9 years old when the portrait was lost. 65 years later, she could not say unequivocally that the painting was an image of her brother's wife, only stating that the eyes in the portrait favored Theodosia's. In 1888, Miss Stella Drake, a fourth cousin Burr descendant, came to Elizabeth City to see the portrait. At the time, Dr. Poole's widow was living at the Airy, their home on the Pasquotank River. Mrs. Drake told Mrs. Poole that when she was a child, her mother would tell her a bedtime story about Theodosia and the pirates and how they made her walk the plank. She too believed the portrait to be a likeness of Theodosia, stating that it bore a remarkable resemblance to her sister. Dr. Poole died in 1887, and his daughter, Anna Poole Overman, inherited the portrait. Eventually, it was sold out of the family to the William Macbeth Gallery in New York. From there, it passed through other hands before landing in the collection of William Wilmarth Lewis. At his death in 1979, Mr. Lewis bequeathed the painting to Yale University, where it became part of the collection of the Lewis Walpole Library on campus. The library was kind enough to loan it to the Museum of the Albemarle in 2016, where it hung in the museum's Our Story exhibit for 6 months. So the question remains, after more than 200 years, what was the fate of Theodosia Burr Austin? Was she lost in a storm, the victim of pirates, either on land or on the sea? Is she truly the woman in the portrait? Dr. Poole never knew the answer, and neither will we. The one tangible clue is the portrait itself. If these painted lips could speak, what a tale they could tell. But there's nothing of Dorian Gray in this painting, no hint of the fate of the woman portrayed there. It remains a mystery for the ages. It's fitting that Theodosia's portrait was part of the Museum of the Albemarle's Our Story exhibit, because it's very much a part of our story in Northeastern North Carolina. For 56 years, the portrait languished in the wilds of Nags Head Woods in a shack made of the timbers of wrecked ships. For decades, it graced the Poole family homes in Pasquotank County. And for 6 months in 2016, the portrait came back home to Elizabeth City. Today, a copy of the Nags Head portrait hangs in the Our Story exhibit at the Museum of the Albemarle. We'd love for you to come and see her. Thank you.
Thank you, Marjorie, for that wonderful presentation. We have a couple questions for both you and Robin from the chat. So the first one is, have either of you seen a much higher interest in Theodosia since the play Hamilton came out?
I don't know that I have, but I don't know that I would have been in a situation to.
We've always had a lot of interest in Theodosia here at Brookgreen, and people do mention Hamilton from time to time, the play, but Theodosia is so much a part of our folklore here, and you know, there's a ghost story associated with her too, on the coast down here, so she's still very much a part of what goes on in South Carolina coast.
Robin, this question is for you. They're curious if the flags you mentioned are related to Alice flag of Hermitage on Murrells Inlet, do you know?
Yes. Alice was the daughter of Ebenezer and Margaret Blaine Flag, and her two brothers, Arthur and Allard, who were doctors, continued to live in the area even after her death, and their families continued to live here. One of them, in fact, Arthur Flagg, lived on property that's part of Brookgreen. And as of today, a portrait of Alice, painted by George Whiting Flagg, is now in the collection of Brookgreen Gardens.
Oh, wonderful. Congratulations. Our next question is for either of you. Our attendee asks or says, I remember learning in school years ago that Aaron Burr and others in his family eventually went to Canada. Did he do this later or not?
No, I'm not aware of that.
Aaron Burr didn't.
No, and neither did Joseph or Theodosia.
Okay. Our next question is, when their son, Theodosia's son, died, did he die at age 10 or 12?
10.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry. I thought it was 12.
In 1812.
That's my mistake.
Yeah, that's okay. Age 10 in 1812.
Okay.
And a lot of people think 1812 and think 12 years old.
Got it.
That's probably what I did.
The next question is, in modern times, were any attempts made to locate a shipwreck that could potentially be the Patriot?
Not that I'm aware of.
No, I've never heard anyone even express interest in doing that.
That's kind of shocking considering how well known the Burrs are, even to this day. It's interesting that nobody's made an attempt to do that.
No.
We have multiple requests, Robin, for you to tell us the story, the Theodosia ghost story. Would you be willing to do that?
Oh, sure. There are two versions of it. One is that she's seen in the cemetery at the Oaks, which is part of Brookgreen Gardens property. And obviously she's mourning her son and her husband. The other part of the story is that she can be heard crying near the site of the house known as the castle, which was the Alston family beach house that's now part of the Debidou development. The foundation of the house is still there, the brick foundations, parts of it, but the ocean has encroached so much that there's not a lot of it left. But if you walk on the beach there, supposedly you can hear her crying.
Marjorie, this question is for you. Can you remind us when you said that the Patriot left and then crashed?
It left in December 30th. I don't know that it crashed, but it left on December 30th, 1812. And that's the last time it was ever seen.
Okay. The next question is, what do either or both of you think of the book, The Watery Part of the World?
Oh, it's been a while since I read it. I don't know. I don't know.
I'm not familiar with it. No, I haven't. Yeah.
No.
Maybe it sounds like maybe I need to.
Sounds Fair like enough. I need to reread it.
Our next question is, do either of you know if any carbon dating has been done on the painting of Theodosia?
I don't believe so. I've never heard that it has. Mm-mm.
No, I would think if something like that had occurred that we'd have some things perhaps decided if the dates don't correspond. But no, I've never
it's actually
heard
a
of
good
that
idea.
Having occurred.
Mm-mm.
All right, and then our next question is: can you please address the family lineage question? I've seen a grave in Eastern Wake County. That is of Sally K. Jones, 1795 to 1874, daughter of James and Sally Alston. Is this the sister of William Alston, an aunt of Joseph in the story? She married Seth Jones, a wealthy landowner in our part of Wake County. Any ideas on that?
There was a North Carolina branch of the Alston family, but they weren't closely related to the South Carolina branch. When the first Alstons began to arrive in the colonies, there were two brothers that stayed in South Carolina and one that headed up to North Carolina. And I don't remember their first names specifically, but there was a well-established Alston family in North Carolina. And it is spelled with a single L. It does need to be said that the name most likely was spelled with a single L to begin with in England. And somewhere along the way, a second L was added. And then William Alston of Clifton dropped that second L to make things easier record keeping at that point in time, but it's crazy now because trying to trace some of these families because they weren't always consistent in keeping the single or the double L, even in the same family.
Our next question is, what other images of Theodosia exist in other institutions? Do you all know of many different portraits of her, or is it kind of just the few that you shared this evening? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that what was shown between my presentation and Marjorie's presentation are probably all of the images that we know of. But, you know, they're in the New York Historical Society, Yale University collection, the Gibbs Museum in Charleston, and a lot of them are still in private hands too, you know, and family members have them. And what happened through the years too is that many times an original painting was copied, especially in a miniature size, so that someone in the family who wanted it 50 years after Theodosia's death could have it, could have an image of her. So, you know, that has occurred quite a lot.
Our next question is, did Dr. Poole ever note that the portrait looked damaged when it came into his possession? Potentially water damage from a shipwreck or any sort of damage. Do either of you know?
I've never heard of any account that it was damaged. You know, Dr. Poole wrote about this, and his daughter, who was a writer, wrote an account of it. And nobody ever mentioned, if it was damaged, nobody ever mentioned it.
Okay. The next question or request is, can either of you refer to any materials, books on the Alstons of North Carolina? Would be appreciated.
I can't.
There is a book that is out of print. Let's see, I'm trying to reach back to my bookshelf. I think it's called The Alstons and Alstons of North and South Carolina. So I believe that Dover reprinted it some years ago, but you might be able to Google that and find a reprint somewhere. It's very difficult to follow, I will tell you that, but it does have information about the North Carolina Alstons.
Wonderful. Okay. And our last question is, are either of you familiar with the work Dear Theodosia, Collected Letters of Aaron Burr with His Daughter? And if so, what are your thoughts?
I'm not.
I have heard of it, but I've never looked at it. Believe it or not, Theodosia isn't the only thing that we deal with here at Brookgreen. So I have not recently, like in the last 15 years or so, done a lot of research into her. I know that more information is online now than there used to be, and it's easier to get some of this material, but I'll certainly check into that book, see what it has to say.
That's the nature of historians, right? There's always more information to learn, always more information coming to the surface. It's kind of what makes it fun. You never stop learning.
Oh, yeah. Well, we learn every day.
All right. Well, I want to thank you both for joining us this evening and for your wonderful presentations. We truly do appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And you sharing your knowledge of Theodosia, her history, and the Nags Head portrait with us. It's been wonderful. And I want to thank you all who joined us for this evening. It was wonderful for us to have a virtual trip to South Carolina and then to the Outer Banks of our coast. We hope to see you at our next History and Highballs, Salisbury, Looking Back Towards the Future. That's happening on Thursday, September 2nd at 7 p.m. We hope to see you all there. Thank you, Marjorie. Thank you, Robin. Have a good evening, everybody.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you.